Okay, welcome back everyone. So I have let me give you some information about what the exam would look like. So the exam it will cover from chapters 7 to 10, but only those that I really mentioned in class. And I'm considering like 30% of them, of the problem, will be just definitions. I mean, should be not difficult if you understand the definition, okay? And another 30% will be based on proofs that I did in class. Of course, everything is in class. Definition, if you understood the definitions that you learned in class, shouldn't be a big problem for this. Another 30% shouldn't be a big problem if you understood proofs that I did in class. And the last 40, this will be based on homework problems. So if you understood homework problems, then yeah, should be easy. Okay? And it will be in class. We will do this on Tuesday, June 18th, I remember. Any questions about the exam? Okay, so today we will continue studying root systems. And last time we defined Dynkin diagram. So if R is a root system, and delta is a base, say delta is alpha 1 dot 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 alpha R, and the Dynkin diagram of R with respect to this choice of the base is the graph. Is the graph on these vertices 1, 2, 3, dot, 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 n, for one vertex for each base element, and we connect them no edge between two vertices if the angle is 1 over pi over 2, so where this is alpha I, alpha j. So when we have two vertices, we have corresponding simple roots. And if theta is the angle between them, then we have these four situations, because we know that for any two root positive simple roots, the angles, we have only a few choices. And in this case, we know that if you select any two simple roots, then their angle must be obtuse, bigger than or equal to pi over 2. So we have only these four choices. So if theta is 3 pi over 4, if theta is 5 pi over 6, they correspond, in this case, alpha I, the length is equal to alpha j. We are assuming that alpha I is bigger than or equal to, say, alpha. Yeah, we may assume that alpha I is bigger than or equal to alpha j. And here is like this time square root of 2. In this case, the same thing with square root of 3. We have four possibilities. And here we have this I, j, with triple edge, with arrow like that. Okay, so Dynkin diagram is a directed graph, or we may have some multiple edges like that, and have things like that. Okay. Basically, it tells us the connection between the relation between the two roots, two simple roots. Because Dynkin diagram is a graph, we can talk about some we can say whether two Dynkin diagrams are isomorphic or not. So two Dynkin diagrams are isomorphic. This is really the terminology in graph theory. If they are isomorphic as directed graphs with multiple edges. So, in more precisely, in other words, let's say D1 is the Dynkin diagram with edge set, a vertex set V1, an edge set, directed edge set E2, and D2 is another Dynkin diagram like this. Then we say that these are isomorphic if there exists bijection, say phi from one vertex set to the other, such that small number of edges and directed edges direction between these two vertices U and V in this is equal to the same situation between the corresponding vertices. Okay, so whenever we have two vertices on one side, because we have a bijection between the vertex set, so we can consider the corresponding vertices and they look exactly the same as before. So for example, I think it's best to explain using example. So for instance, suppose that we have a diagram like this. So it's really, so it means isomorphic. This is isomorphic to say 1, 3, 2, 4. All you need to do is to find the bijection between the vertices. Or in other words, you just relabel the vertices, then you get the other one. And, but this is not isomorphic to, say, 1, 3, 2, 4 with directed edges like that. And this is also not isomorphic to 1, 3, 2, 4. This. They are not isomorphic because they look similar, but the directions are not quite the same. So in other words, if they look exactly the same except just relabeling, then they are isomorphic. So. So I define the Dynkin diagram of a root system using a particular choice of a base, delta. But in fact, the Dynkin diagram only depends on the root system, not on the choice of the base. In other words, if you choose a different base, then you may get a different looking or a Dynkin diagram, not exactly the same, but it will be isomorphic to the previous one. So, proposition, the Dynkin diagram of a root system R is independent of the choice of a base delta. Up to isomorphism, of course, up to isomorphism. Actually, proof is quite simple, so let's see the proof. So let's consider two bases, the two bases of R, and then we will consider two Dynkin diagrams, one for this, one for the other. But we know that then there is, because we know that for two different bases, we can find the Weigruf element sending one base to the other. There is a Weigruf element such that if you apply this, then you get the other one. So it's a theorem or proposition we learned before. And what does that mean? So W sends two elements, say alpha, beta, in the base delta 1 to two elements W alpha and W beta in. So we will have, so basically this is the bijection. We have one alpha. There is a vertex corresponding to alpha. We will send this to the vertex corresponding to W alpha. And all we need to do is to check whether the two have these two vertices have exactly the same directed edge structure. But then, it only depends on the angle between the two, roots. Because the definition of the linking diagram is like, it depends only on the angle between the two roots. And if the thing is, if we have like alpha beta here, this may change to a different, I don't know, let's write something like that, W alpha, W beta, but the angle must be the same, because the angle between alpha and beta is the same as the angle between W alpha and W beta. Why? Because it preserves the length. It preserves the length, or in general, W is an orthogonal transformation, so W alpha, W beta is the same as alpha beta, in general, for any vectors alpha and beta. So it preserves, you can write down the angle using this. Or what's the angle if you want? So cosine theta is equal to alpha beta, is that alpha beta, right? And if you say this is theta prime, then cosine theta prime is W alpha, W beta. But, you know, they agree come by term. So they are the same because of this, for any two roots or any vector. So they have exact same structure, so it's a linking diagram isomorphy. So you can talk about the linking diagram without specifying a particular base, okay? All right. So what's nice about this linking diagram is that it gives us a lot of information about the root system, and it contains all the information of the root system, by the way, in a very compact way. And it also has very nice connection with Lie algebra. So proposition 8.32. So first, R is irreducible if and only if Dynkin diagram of R is connected, right? So we have a root system, we can talk about the Dynkin diagram, and if the Dynkin diagram is connected as a graph, we don't, the underlying graph, so we don't really consider the direction, okay? So if the whole graph is connected without considering the direction, then the root system is irreducible. It cannot be written as an orthogonal direct sum of two non-trivial root systems. That's the definition of this. And second, the Dynkin diagram completely determines, let me write in just this way, Dynkin diagram of R1 if Dynkin diagram of R2, if they are isomorphic as graphs, then root systems are isomorphic. So root system is completely determined by the Dynkin diagram. I'm not going to prove this. And corollary, because we know some connection between root systems and semisimple Lie algebra. So suppose that G is a semisimple Lie algebra. And H is the Cartan subalgebra. And we know that this root system, it lives inside this I times T, this maximal commutative subgroup, subalgebra. The root system of G relative to H. So we kind of define a root system associated to each a semi-simple Lie algebra in this way. And then G is simple. We knew that G is simple if and only if R is irreducible, but R is irreducible if and only if the Dynkin diagram is connected. So Dynkin diagram of R connected. Nice theorem. Using this, we can classify all simple Lie algebra. So there will be in the next chapter, we will see a classification theorem for simple Lie algebra. Okay. And that's for the Dynkin diagrams. And we will now consider some properties of roots or vectors in the root ambient space. Okay, so the next section about integral and dominant integral elements. Actually, we have heard of these terms, like integral element, or integral weight, or dominant weight, like when we study the representations of SL3, right? But it's kind of a long time ago. But there is a definition for the general situation. And eventually, this will be used to study the representation of other semi-simple Lie algebra. So definition, this will be a very important definition, because we will be using very often. Suppose that we have a root system, and we choose a base of a root system. And let's say mu is an element in the vector space E. Okay? Then we say that mu is an integral element if for all roots alpha I wish I had more space. This is equivalent, this is a coroot, so 2 mu alpha alpha alpha, if this is an integer for every root alpha. That's the definition. Okay, and mu is dominant, and actually relative to the choice of delta. If for all alpha, for all delta, so the simple root, alpha inner product with mu is greater than or equal to zero, always positive. And we say that this mu is strictly dominant if for all alpha this is positive. This is in fact the same definition that we learned for when we study the weights of representations of SL3. So it's, but we are now considering more general situation. Okay. Let's see what this means. So note, mu is dominant. Actually, it means, the dominant means if you take the inner product with every simple root, it will be non-negative. And this is in fact the same thing as mu is in the closure of the Weyl chamber, or fundamental Weyl chamber. So this is the closure of the fundamental Weyl chamber, because that's the basically the definition. So open, we are only considering open Weyl chamber. Weyl chamber, fundamental Weyl chamber means this chamber where set of vectors that has positive inner product with every simple root. So that is really the definition, and if this is strictly dominant, if and only if mu is in the fundamental open Weyl chamber. Okay, so you should really think of this as an element in here and strictly dominant element in the fundamental Weyl chamber, etc. Okay, so it's really the definition. Okay, let's recall what we learned last time. Recall from proposition 8.29, if C is a Weyl chamber and H is just a vector, then we can find a Weyl group element such that if you apply this Weyl group element to this chosen vector, we can make it inside the Weyl chamber, a closure of the Weyl chamber. Okay. So initially, this vector is outside of the Weyl chamber, but if you kind of keep applying, or you can always find a Weyl group element, so that if you apply that element to this vector, then you can make it to this inside this closure of the Weyl chamber. Okay, proposition. For every vector there exists. So what does this mean? Actually, this is really the same thing as this proposition, such that it's dominant. It is just a rephrase of this statement, okay? Because dominant means it is inside this fundamental Weyl chamber. So take this as to be the fundamental Weyl chamber, then fundamental Weyl chamber is, of course, a Weyl chamber. So you can always find a Weyl group element so that W applied to mu, it will be inside this Weyl chamber closure. So, but if it is in a closure of the fundamental vial chamber, that means it is dominant. Okay, that's just a rephrase of the of what I just wrote. It's a nice thing to remember. Let's note two more things. First, every root is indeed an integral element, because it's really by definition. You know, the root system is a collection of non-zero roots satisfying these four conditions, and one of them is just this, right? One of them is this. So it's really, every root is an integral element. And because every root is an integral element, if you take the linear combination of them with an integer coefficient, it will also be an integral element. So every integer linear combination of roots is an integral element, because individual one is an integral element. It's really just the definition, right? Follows immediately from the definition. But the converse is not true. There are integral elements which are not expressible as an integer linear combination of roots. Okay, let me give you an example. I'm going to show you the example in the next page. I want to make it a little bigger. So example A2, the root system A2. I think I can draw. I'm going to draw like this. It's a little difficult to draw. Curvy, but should be, you know what I mean. They're all straight lines. Okay, so in this triangular grid, and we have these six roots. They all have same length, right? So let's say this is alpha 2, alpha 1, and these two vectors, they form a base of the root system. And okay, in this case, I'm gonna put dots. These are the dominant elements. These are the dominant elements. So these are dominant. Let's call this or this. This is mu 1, this is mu 2. Can you see? Mu 1, mu 2. Mu 1 is 2/3 of alpha 1 plus 1/3 alpha 2. And mu 2 is 1/3 alpha 1 plus 2/3 alpha 2. As you can see, mu 1, mu 2, they are integral elements, but it's not an integer linear combination of alpha 1 and alpha 2. Okay? And by the way, how can you check whether this mu 1 is an integral element? The definition So notice that we have seen this already, but to remind you, it has some meaning, geometric meaning. This means, because this quantity, without the factor 2, this quantity is, we project this vector mu onto alpha, and this is the ratio of the projection with respect to alpha. So in other words, the projection of mu onto alpha is an integer, because it's multiplied by 2, or a half integer multiple of alpha. So if you want a diagram, so if this is alpha and if this is mu, you project this onto alpha like that. This is C times alpha, right? And what this is saying is that this C must be, 2 times C must be an integer. So C is either, it could be an integer, but, or it is an integer over 2. Okay? So let's see if this is really the case. So mu1, so we want to check whether mu1 is an integral element. Project this onto every root and then see if that really, half integer multiple of the root, that root. The drawing is not really good, but the projection is this. So if you project mu1 onto alpha1, then what is that? It is half of the alpha1, so that's good. If you project mu1 to alpha2, what is the projection? The zero, so it's okay. Project this onto this vector, then what is that? Actually, that's the same as this one. So it's a minus 2 of this. So if you check everything, then it's always that vector times integer or half integer multiple. So they really are integral elements. And dominant means they have to have this acute angle between alpha 1 and alpha 2. So you can see this is the hyperplane or line perpendicular to alpha 1. So everything on this side have positive acute angle with alpha 1. And also, so we have this side, and also this is alpha line perpendicular to alpha 2. So this part, they have positive angle, acute angle with alpha 2, so the intersection will be this part, so that's why the dominant elements are here. Okay? So the definition of an integral element is that you take the inner product, or this part, with every root, then we must have an integer. But but we don't really have to consider all the roots. We only need to consider the simple roots. That's enough. So the proposition, we don't have to check them all, or all the roots. So mu is integral. Integral means the integral element. If and only if, for all alpha in the chosen base, 2 mu alpha, this part is this. So the definition, in the definition, this is not delta but R. But the proposition says that it's enough to check only those in delta, in a base. So let's prove this. One side is clear, this part is clear, right? Because by definition, this is true not just for this, but for all R, so this is clear. So we have to prove the other one, the other direction. Suppose that this is the case, and then we want to show that mu is an integral element. How can we do that? We need to show, we want to show that for all beta in a root system, mu is enough to show this. It's an integer. Because this is really what this is. It's the same thing as this. Or, of course, alpha is, if you want, this part is. By the definition of the coroot, mu, beta. So if this is an integer for every root, then that's it. That's what an integral element means. So how can we do that? And we know that, recall, if delta is a base, actually it is, then delta check is a base of R check, right? So what is this? Delta check means collection of all coroots, H alpha. Of course, this is the dual root system, H alpha. Okay, so this is a theorem that we learned before. So we will use this dual base and dual root system. Okay, so now we consider let's consider arbitrary element, arbitrary root. We want to show this, okay? And we know that since H beta is in, say, R check, because that's the definition, we can write H alpha as a linear sum of H alphas for alpha in the base C alpha, okay? Or if you want, this is really H alpha, the same thing. You can see they are really the same thing, right? So oh yeah. That's right. Thank you. We want to write H beta in terms of as a linear combination of H alphas. Okay? So now what's that? And by the definition of the root, right? This is a root. This is a base. So C alpha are all non-negative integers, right? Every root, if you have a root, then you can express this as a non-negative integer linear combination of simple roots. Okay? Because these are the simple roots of R check. Now, all we need to do is, we're almost done. Mu, what is this? Write this in terms of this, summation alpha, C alpha, mu, H alpha. Okay? But we know that these are non-negative integers, and these are non-negative integers. Why is that? Why is this non-negative integer? That's the assumption. This is mu h alpha, right? By assumption, this is a non-negative integer. Let me write it this way. Non-negative integers. This is also non-negative integers. Some of non-negative integers, of course, is a non-negative integer. So that's the end of the proof. Oh, I think we cannot really say that it's non-negative integers, right? It's only an integer. I'm sorry about that. So it's an integer. Yeah, it is true, but we don't really need this non-negative, because all we need is that this is an integer. Okay? So it's enough to check whether this inner product or this value is an integer for every simple root, not for all roots. So it'll is everything okay? All right. We need. So, by the way, I specify these mu1 and mu2, and actually, they are, in fact, very important elements. So, we're going to give a name to them. Definition, root system. We have a root system as before, and we have chosen a base, alpha 1, alpha r, as a base. And the fundamental elements, of course, is with respect to this choice, it depends on the choice. Fundamental elements are the elements, say mu1, mu2, dot dot dot, mu r, such that for all jk, two times this kind of inner product. Or this is the same as mu j comma h alpha k. This is 1 over 0 depending on jk. So if j I equals k, the value will be 1, otherwise it will be 0. So mu j is orthogonal to everything, every alpha k except alpha j. And for when k equals j, we have this relation. Actually, it's not, it may not be completely clear, but actually it's not that difficult to show that fundamental elements exist and are uniquely. So it's a basic linear algebra, so I'm not going to prove it. There is a unique set of fundamental elements. Oh, actually, it's not elements, sorry. So weight, we say that weight. Fundamental weight. Fundamental weight. Mu1, dot, 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 mu r. So basic linear algebra, you can just check it. And second, this is what I mentioned. Mu j is orthogonal to alpha k for all k different from j. Because that's what this means. This part, if this is 0, the numerator must be 0. So if this is 0, means it's orthogonal. They are orthogonal. And what about k equals j case? And projection of mu j onto alpha j is what? Can you tell me the projection? This is 1. That means alpha j over 2, yes. Because without this, it will be alpha j, but we have this factor 2, so is half of the alpha 2, so 1 over 2 alpha j. And third, mu is a dominant integral element if and only if mu is a combination linear non-negative integer combination of mu j, the fundamental weight. So here, cj, non-negative integers. And this is integral element, if and only if the same condition, where of course now we don't have to have this positive condition. Yeah, from this, you can see that these really fundamental weights must also form a base or basis of the roots of the vector space E. So, okay, let's see. Okay, one more definition. Now I'm going to show this kind of thing in a diagram. Let me define one more thing. Delta a base for R. We define this special element, delta. This is just half of the sum of all positive roots. Why are we doing this? Because this element plays an important role in our study. This is kind of a special element. And I'm going to show you some diagram in the B2 and G2 case. And let's see if you can really see this kind of thing from there. So this is B2, type B2 root system. Okay, so we can pick alpha 1 and alpha 2. So they form a base, which we chose the base like that, delta is like that. And mu 1, mu 2, they are the fundamental weights. Because how can we check whether they are fundamental weight? So mu 1, is this orthogonal to alpha 2? Yes. And what is the projection of mu 1 onto alpha 1? We project this like that. That's half of alpha 1. So it's a fundamental weight, right? What about mu 2? Mu 2, is this orthogonal to mu 1? Yes, it is orthogonal. And if you project this onto alpha 2, it's half of alpha 2. So they really are the fundamental weights. And what about delta? Delta, so, okay, what are the positive roots? So these two, they are the simple roots. Positive roots are those that can be written as a positive linear sum of these. They are in fact this one and this one. All right? This and this. And so sum of this plus this plus this plus this, and half of that, that will be a delta. Can you see that? I don't know. What's the easiest way to see this? But by the way, the fact is, delta is always the sum of the fundamental weight. So if you take the sum of these, it will be this. But can you prove it? Yeah, think about it. Yeah. But if you really want... this plus this is going to be aware here. And this plus this is where? I don't know. I have to go this here, right? This plus this is this. So half of that, that will be this. Do you see? It's a basic, vector, And this is G2, the same thing. Alpha 1, alpha 2, they form a base, we chose base like that. And what are the fundamental weights? So mu1, mu2, they are the fundamental weights because mu1, it is orthogonal to alpha2. It is also, so projection of mu1 onto alpha1 is half of alpha1, that's good. Alpha2, mu2 is orthogonal to alpha1. Project mu2 onto alpha2, that's half of alpha2, so this is good. And again, the positive roots are like this one, this, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have 6 positive roots. If you sum them all, then there will be somewhere like over here. And then if you take the, divide it by 2, then you will get delta. And again, you can see delta is the sum of mu1 and mu2. Any question? Oh yeah, by the way, I forgot to mention these two rays and those the region in, between these two rays, that's the region for the dominant elements. The things inside will be the dominant elements, and these dots, they represent dominant integral elements. So everything, every dot is a linear, integer linear combination of mu1 and mu2, as you can see. And every point here in the, on the grid, they are integral elements. Same here. So this region is a set of dominant elements or fundamental chamber, fundamental Weyl chamber. And these dots, they are the integral dominant elements, dominant integral elements. And they can always be written as an integer linear combination of these two fundamental. For instance, this one is sum of mu1, mu2. What is this? This is 2 times mu1. This is what? Mu2 plus 2 mu1, etc. So everything is can be written as an integral integer linear combination. That's how you can understand this diagram. All right. Yes. So, what is this? Okay, yes. I didn't do anything. We have to just wait. Sometimes we have to wait just like that. All right. A proposition 8.38. Delta is a strictly dominant integral element. Why? Or in other words, the same thing as saying that beta equals 1 for all beta simple roots. This is the same thing as this. Because strictly, of course, it's not if and only if. This implies this, right? In fact, moreover, this is true. So we will prove this. If we prove this, we know that this is positive, strictly positive, so it's strictly dominant. And this is always an integer for a simple root. That means it is integer for every root, so it is the integral. Okay, so it's enough to show this. Let's prove this. The proof is quite interesting. So let beta be an arbitrary simple root like this. And by proposition 8.30, this says that S beta, for any simple root, beta, this permute all positive root except beta. Do you remember? We prove something like this. We have positive root, and then if you pick one simple root, and then you consider the reflection, simple reflection, then of course this will change beta to minus beta, but the remaining part, they may be changed to another one, but they are all positive. Okay, so it permutes this. This is a proposition that we showed. Therefore, let's see what happens if we apply S beta to delta. Okay, but this is just a definition, 1 over 2, I'm writing this. But I'm going to separate this, the two cases, whether alpha is not equal to beta or alpha is equal to beta, right? I just separated these two cases. But then, of course, this is linear. This is an orthogonal transformation. So this, what happens if I apply this to this? If you apply S beta to this, then what do we get? It doesn't change. It does change term by term, but if you collect them together, because S beta only permutes them, you just rearrange the terms, but you know, addition is commutative if you want. So it's the same. The first term doesn't really change. But what about the second term? You apply S beta to beta, that will be minus beta. But this is almost the same as delta, except we have minus, so this is in fact delta minus beta. Do you see? Because if this were plus, it will be delta, but it's not plus, but minus, so we have to subtract 2 beta, but together with this, we see. Then what? So we want to compute this, beta, delta. But this is the same thing as S beta, delta. Why? Because S beta is an orthogonal transformation. So reflection, it preserves the inner product. So we know that this should be minus beta, and we know that this is delta minus beta. So what's that? It's minus beta, delta, plus beta, beta. Finally, we can just compute, or if you compare these two sides, then we can really write beta, delta. You move this to the other side and then divide by 2, then we get this, right? Then we are done. 2 beta delta over beta beta. We know that this is beta beta, so it's 1. That's the proof. So for this special element delta, if you consider this, it's always 1. All right. Now I'm going to move on to the next section. The partial ordering. So if you remember, when we studied the representation of SL3, we learned very important theorem called the theorem of highest weight. So every irreducible representation is a highest weight cyclic representation, right? We showed that. But what does a highest weight mean? So it is higher, it is a weight that is higher than other weights. But in order to talk about something is higher than the other, then we have to define the ordering of the weight. So this is what we are going to do in this section. So basically, later on we will generalize this the theorem of highest weight to a general situation, like simple, semi-simple, for semi-simple case. So delta is, as usual, a base. And that, let's say, let's consider two elements in the roots, in the vector space. We say that mu is higher than alpha, lambda, or equivalently, lambda is lower, the same thing, than mu, and we denoted mu, this is a notation like a little curly inequality, or of course it's the same thing as this. It should be something like that, but I'm not bothered that much to draw very carefully. If mu minus lambda, because this is an element in the vector space, we can write this uniquely as a linear combination of the simple roots. But then, for all c, coefficient must be positive. Then we say that mu is higher than lambda. Well, lambda is lower than mu. So this is a partial order. That means sometimes we cannot compare two elements. Maybe I can show you some example. Let's consider B2. This is say alpha 1, alpha 2. By the way, these, they are the dominant, this is the dominant elements are here, or the fundamental file chamber. What are the okay. We want to, let's consider those vectors greater than or equal to zero or higher than zero. There will be so what does that mean? This means mu is alpha C1 alpha 1 plus C2 alpha 2 with C1 C2 greater than or equal to 0. That means it must be on this side because we want to have positive coefficient with alpha 2. It must have this side. This side. So in total, those are the vectors in this side. These are the set of elements like that, right? And in particular, you can see that dominant element is higher than zero. But higher than zero doesn't mean always mean that dominant. Okay, let's prove this. Also, by the way, we will prove this. We will prove that dominant element always satisfies this. Okay? Like this example. But we need to prepare something to prove it. So some fact. Suppose that we have a basis, basis for the vector space E, then there exists a unique set of vectors, so unique vectors V1 dot star dot 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 VR star, of course in the vector space, such that VJ star VK is JK for all JK. And these vectors, actually this is called a dual basis. When we have a basis, we can consider that it's dual basis. And it's possible to find these, and unique, they are unique. And there's a fact that we are not going to prove, but it looks quite reasonable in some sense. Suppose that V1 dot 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 VR, this is a basis of E such that VJ, VK, their inner product is always negative or less than or equal to. Is this right? I thought it was. I think it should be this. Oh no, that's right. Obtuse. This means obtuse. The angle is bigger than 90 degrees for all j different than k. Then, so it's like a we say obtuse basis. For any pair of basis elements, their angle is kind of obtuse. Then, the dual basis. V1 star dot 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 VR is an acute basis, meaning i.e. VJ star VK star always greater than or equal to zero. I'm not going to prove this, but let me show you an example why this is reasonable. Well, of course, this is not a proof. It's like a P2 root system, so consider these two, V1 and V2. They form an obtuse basis, right? The angle, because the angle is greater than this. What are the dual basis elements? So they are, like, I think this is V1 star, this is V2 star. You can check. And their angle is smaller than pi over 2. So, yeah. This is an example of this lemma. But I'll omit the proof. But instead, I'm going to prove the following proposition, which is quite interesting. If mu is dominant, this is the thing that I mentioned, then it is greater than or higher than zero. We will use that lemma, proof. Okay. So let delta be the base. Then this is in fact on an obtuse basis of E. We know this because simple roots, they form negative inner product. So for any, okay, so let's consider, let's say, I don't know, delta star, the dual basis. Let's not write this because it's not really. Okay, that just does what I wanted to do. This is the dual basis is an acute basis, right? the dual basis. And what's nice about this dual basis is that for any V, we can write as a linear combination of alpha j, because alpha j, they form a basis. But suppose that we want to know cj. What is cj? Take the inner product with cj star, both sides. Then we will only get one term here. So it's going to be c. This is this, right? So, for all v, we can write this in this way. Right? I just replace this by this coefficient. In particular, let's write alpha j star as in this form. Then this is going to be let's say j k alpha k. Yeah, because this part should go over here. Is this okay? I just replace v by j, and of course replace j by k. Now what? So mu, we want to show that mu is greater than or higher than zero. So let's write mu in the same way. This is true for every vector, so this is true. What we are going to do here is we want to show that, what do we want to show? We want to show that these are all non-negative. Then that will be enough, because that's the definition of this. Okay, this means zero minus mu minus zero, which is just mu. If you expand this in terms of as a linear combination of the basis element, then the coefficient must be non-negative. But how can we show this? In this way. So the trick here is that we expand this using this. We can write this as a linear combination like that. So let's say star, phi star. This is going to be summation k. I'm just copy this, alpha k star, alpha j star, alpha j, and mu. Now, of course, this is linear, so we can write and then alpha j mu, right? Now what? This is always greater than or equal to zero. Why? Because of this. This means alpha j star, alpha k star, always positive or non-negative. And this is greater than or equal to zero. Why? Dominant. That's the definition of the dominant. Dominant means inner product with alpha j is always greater than or equal to zero. So everything is non-negative, so the whole thing is non-negative, and that's the end of the proof. Okay, I think I should stop here. Thank you for your attention.